शमी कृषि प्रभु जी, सो टुडे वील कंटिन्यू फ्रॉम श्रीमद् भागवतम फोर्थ कैंटो फोर्थ चैप्टर एंड नाइन्थ वर्स. जस्ट अ क्विक इंट्रोडक्शन अबाउट शमी कृषि प्रभु जी. सो प्रभु जी इज अ वेरी सीनियर श्रीला प्रभुपाद डिसाइपल एंड ऑल्सो इनिशिएटिंग गुरु. सो ही हैज बीन अ डॉक्टर बाय प्रोफेशन एंड इन सर्विंग गृहस्थ आश्रम फॉर अ वेरी लॉन्ग टाइम विद द होल फैमिली. And exemplifying how in a setting of a grihastha how we can do Vaishnava Seva as well as attain love for Krishna. So we are very grateful to Prabhuji for joining us every week and speaking his precious words and answering the questions in the end. So please feel free to ask any questions after the class. I'll hand over to Vaishnavi Shikha.
Thank you so much, Prabhu. It's a very auspicious day, beginning of Purushottam Mass. So we should dedicate in more chanting, more reading, more devotee association. And thank you for giving me opportunity. Please accept my obeisances. Vancha Kalpataru Bhyascha Kripa Sindhu Evacha Patita Nam Pavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Nama. नमो ओम विष्णु पदाय कृष्णा प्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्ति वेदांत स्वामिनीति नामिने नमस्ते सारस्वती देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य दिशतारिणे श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद हरे कृष्णा कृष्ण कृष्ण हरे 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 राम 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 हरे हरे. Yes, already announced that we will be reading Canto 4, Chapter 4, Text number 9 and 10. This is topic about Sati. She quits her body. So Sati, as we read in previous verses, Sati gets a cold response from Daksha Prajapati. So without even invitation, Sati reaches the Daksha's sacrificial arena, which was very, very splendid with chanting of the Vedic hymns. Sacrificial animals were there and great personalities and various paraphernalia were there. But no one received Sati properly out of fear of Daksha, because they knew that Daksha and Lord Shiva has animosity, or so nobody received her properly. Only her mother and sisters embraced her with tears of affection and glad faces. But Sati did not accept this, the seat and the gifts offered by her sisters, mother and aunts, and did not reply to their words of reception, because her father did not welcome her. Her father, yes, sister and mother and sisters, they did welcome her, but because the father was very cold, so she was not very happy. And Sati became very angry when she noticed that Daksha that he has any place for oblations given to Lord Shiva, and because she was Shiva's wife, and so that's why Daksha, although she was the dearest daughter of Daksha, he did not welcome her. So in this way, the Sati became greatly angry and looked at Daksha as if she were going to burn him. So we'll be reading, that is the this text number 9. रुद्रभागं तमवेक्ष चाध्वरं पित्रा च देवे कृतहेलनं विभौ अनाद्रता यज्ञ सदस्यधीश्वरी चुकोपलोर्का निवदक्षतिरुषा. Present in the arena of the sacrifice, Sati saw that there were no oblations for her husband, Lord Shiva. Next, she realized that not only had her father failed to invite Lord Shiva, but when he saw Lord Shiva's exalted wife, Daksha did not receive her either. Thus, she became greatly angry, so much so that she looked at her father as if she were going to burn him with her eyes. Purport: by offering oblations in the fire while chanting the Vedic mantra Swaha, one offers respect to all the demigods, great sages and pitas, including Lord Brahma, Lord Shiva and Lord Vishnu. It is customary that Shiva is one of those who are offered respects, but Sati, while personally present in the arena, saw that Brahmanas did not utter the mantra offering oblations to Shiva, Lord Shiva. Namah Shivaya Swaha. She was not sorry for herself, for she was ready to come to her father's house without being invited. But she wanted to see whether or not her husband was being respected. To see her relatives, her sisters and mother was not so important. Even when she was received by her mother and sisters, she did not care, for she was most concerned that her husband was being insulted in the sacrifice. When she marked the insult, she became greatly angry and she looked at her father so angrily that Daksha appeared to burn in her vision. Om Agyante Mirandasya Gyananjana Shalakaya Chakshuran Militam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namah. So, from this purport and translation, it looks that Sati did not really come to greet her mother or sister, but her main aim to remove this animosity. She wanted to see personally that whether this whether her father is respecting her husband. So her main aim, because she was the most chaste lady, and she wanted that whatever the place of Lord Shiva is there in the all these sacrifices, because the purpose of sacrifice to not only please all the demigods, but ultimately by the Swaha and by offering our obeisances, Lord Vishnu is satisfied. But there should be place of, like in Bhagavad Gita also, that if he by this yajnas, if he satisfy all the demigods, because demigods are in charge of this material nature and they give supply enough of everything for everybody to live peacefully, and ultimately the person can worship Krishna. But if he is not peaceful, then it is very difficult for the person to conduct his Krishna consciousness. So these yajnas are necessary, but the ultimate purpose of yajna, yajna purush is Vishnu. Yajna vai Vishnu, or we have to satisfy Vishnu ultimately. But here she sees, she came to just see what is happening, because Daksha and Lada Shiva, father-in-law and the son-in-law, both were envious, both were not respectful to each other, not each other. Lada Shiva did not mind, but Daksha did not like Lada Shiva, and just to show him down, that I would not invite. He started this Vajpayee Yajna. There was another Yajna for 1,000 years was going on. But then another Satra he started just to put Lord Shiva's position even more down. Out of envy, out of so much anger towards that my beautiful daughter is married to, why she is married to Lord Shiva who has no place to stay. So in this way, and Sati wanted to come and see what is happening there, whether there is any place like a seat for Lord Shiva or not, whether they are putting oblations to Lord Shiva by chanting this mantra Namah Shivaya Swaha. So, and when she saw that this is not happening, she did not really care about the reception by her mother and by her sisters. But her father was very, very cold, and he did not speak any word to Sati, although she was the dearest daughter out of the 16 daughters. She was the dearest and youngest to all those 16 daughters, but now she became nothing. So this is the material way of life, that attachment, if you are not attached to somebody, you just disrespect, you do anything. So in this way, Sati was not happy at all. She wanted to, like, as if to look in an anger mood, as if to burn Daksha. We see that just by the vision one can burn. Like if you heard about Muchukun. Muchukun was a devotee of the Lord. He fought for the demigods and he was given a boon that you take a good rest and nobody would disturb. If anybody would disturb, he will get burned. So Kalai one came to Mathura, and Kalaivan and then Jarasandha also came from other side. So Krishna ran because he wanted to give darshan to Muchukun and liberate him. So he ran and Kalaivan was just behind. So they were just little bit distance was there. And then Krishna entered into a cave in Mathura, and then it was little bit further away from Mathura. So he entered into the cave and then he put his uttariya or outer cloth on top of Muchukun, who was lying there for many, many thousands of years, and then he hid behind. So when Kalevan came, he was just mad with envy and he wanted to kill. So he did not see that Muchukun is so long, so big, and Krishna is just like a child. How he could be so big? But because his chadar uttariya, the outer cloth, was there, he thought that it is Krishna is hiding. So he kicked him. And because of his kick, Kalevan got up and he looked at Kalevan, and he got burnt to ashes right there. Then Muchukun prayed to the Lord and he went back to the spiritual kingdom from there. So by the vision one can burn anyone. When there is somebody is envious or somebody is in angry mood, then his eyes becomes very, very red also. And you could see in the face, and it is a character of some of the ladies that if you don't tell right or again, then they look at you and just by the look as if she will devour or burn. So Sati also wanted to see, appeared that she would burn her by her vision to her father, because she was a daughter, she could not kill. But in any place if you go, if Vaishnavas are blasphemed, not respected, and his place is not given, or if you are talking ill about any Vaishnava, then one should either go away, either cut the tongue, or defeat him in the arguments, or defeat him that no, and another part that either, otherwise you should kill. And she did kill herself later on, so we will read verses after this, and that how she quit her body, and that is the topic of the chapter. Sati quits her body because of her husband was not being respected, not giving the position what he is, and so she did quit her body just by seeing this Vaishnava aparadh. So in a Vaishnava aparadh, we could talk about little bit about Vaishnava aparadh, that there is a Swarup Brahm. That we forget who we are, whether I'm a spirit soul or this body, there is a hriday. So this is the result of Vaishnava aparadh, that you develop this thing. Even if you are a devotee, if you mentally think bad about a Vaishnava, so if it is 10 times, then your test in the chanting gets finished. If it is 100 times, then you start sinful activity in many, many ways. And then if it is 1,000 times, then you give completely your Krishna consciousness. So even the subtle way, so Swarup Brahma, that who am I, Hriday Dourvalyam, and so we talk about it is so much weakness, we only talk or think about our profit, adoration and distinction. There is Asat Rashna, means a hankering for something material, and Aparad Pranavata, that is the Aparad Pranavata. Aparad means you will start doing offenses to the Vaishnavas. And there are many, many stories of Vaishnava aparadh, like Devananda and Vakreshwar Pandit. So Devananda was a nice reciter of Srimad Bhagavatam. But one time, when to hear his katha, this Srivas Thakur came to his place, and then he was in so much in love of Krishna that he was just almost like he's like fainting. So what happened? This Devanand Pandit's disciple thought that he is disturbing our katha. So his disciples picked him up and threw him outside. And although he was in meditation, he was in thinking of Krishna all that time, that position happened because of the intense love for Krishna. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu came and shouted at him that you will never develop your love for Krishna, you will never advance further in Krishna consciousness, you may recite whatever way you want. And so later on, he knew about Bhagavatam and what Vaishnava aparadh is, so later on, Devanand Pandit was, when he was in Jagannath Puri, then he protected Vakreshwar Pandit, another devotee, by serving Vakreshwar Pandit, because in dance he would have fallen down, but somehow he supported him that he does not get injured. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu forgave him by serving to a Vaishnava, and then only he could relieve from his tension of performing a Vaishnava aparadh. So not only Devananda Pandit, but we see this Saubhari Muni, that he had offenses against Garudji, that you cannot come to this site where I am meditating underneath the water. And then this, but fish is the natural food for the for this bird. So for Garudji, Garudji is a big giant eagle. So he could not come there. But what happened? That place became a place when for Kaliya Nag, and Kaliya Nag was staying there just because. And then he was meditating. His meditation got disturbed by copulation, by seeing the copulation of the fishes. And then he went to Mandhata and married to his 50 daughters and remained in the material world for a long time. Later on, he realized that what he is doing, he was almost in such a devotional service, but he left all this just by offending to a Vaishnava. So in this way, our Puranas are filled with so much about Vaishnava Parad, and he is also doing a Vaishnava Parad, becoming anger at the angry and envious of Lord Shiva, and Daksha also. Last is all the prestige, his yajna was finished, he was killed even by Lord Shiva's ganas, and later on he had to accept a goat's head for a long period of time. Then later on he came again as Prachita's child in the Prachina Barisat and Prachita's. Later on we will read about Daksha Prajapati afterwards, what happened. So the next verse that we will read is Jagar Samarsha Vipannaya Gira Sivadvisham Dhumapatha Shamashayam Swatejasa Bhuta Ganan Samuthitan Nigraya Devi Jagato Bhishranvataha. The followers of Lord Shiva, the ghosts, were ready to injure or kill Daksha. But Sati stopped them by her order. She was very angry and sorrowful, and in that mood she began to condemn the process of sacrificial fruitive activities and persons who are very proud of such unnecessary and troublesome sacrifices. She especially condemned her father speaking against him in the presence of all. So these fruitive activities means for the fruits or material gain, one performs these sacrifices or does the demigod worship, but it is not a Vedic demigod worship. As long as it is to worship Krishna or it is to gain Krishna or Krishna's favor, like Katyayani was worshipped by all the gopis, and also Rukmini also worshipped Durga before her marriage, and similar way Sita Devi was also worshipping to give Lord Ramchandra as her husband. So there are demigods are worshipped, but that is the purpose is that they give them like Krishna's association, Krishna's seva or devotional service to the Lord, or so he becomes very favorable. So that part is all right. So this he was doing out of envy, this sacrifice. Then this sacrifice did not hurt all the demigods, particularly the great demigods like Lord Shiva, Brahma or Vishnu. Vishnu is not a demigod, but nonetheless he is in this trinity that people they worship. So he is also part of Vishnu. So Lord Shiva was particularly disrespected, and that was the cause of becoming angry of this Sati. And she, although she was very very angry, but she did not wanted to damage Lord Shiva's Daksha Prajapati's sacrificial arena or kill him, although so many Shiva Ganas were there who came or who accompanied in thousands of number, who accompanied Sati or the daughter of Daksha, who accompanied them, and they wanted to stop this fire sacrifice and kill this, but she refused them not to do it. Out of respect for her father, that she did not do that. But nonetheless, later on when Sati left her body in that arena, then naturally they killed the Daksha Prajapati, and further problems they happened. So in the purport, Srila Prabhupada is writing, the process of offering sacrifice is especially meant to satisfy Vishnu, who is called Yagyesha, because he is the enjoyer of the fruits of all sacrifice. Bhagavad Gita also confirms this fact. The Lord says, Bhuktaram Yajna Tapasam Sarva Loka Maheshwaram Shruhadam Sarva Bhutanam Yajyatva Mam Shantim Rikshati. Knowing me to be the enjoyer of the results of sacrifice, means Krishna is the enjoyer of all the sacrifices and austerities. Yajna Tapasam. Yajna is sacrifice, tapa means austerities. The great controllers of the entire world, and he is the controller. He is Surahadam. So he is Maheshwaram. Maheshwaram means Ishwar means a controller. And Maheshwar is the great controller of the entire world. So, and the friend of, he is the Surahadam Sarvabhutana. He is the friend of all the Bhuta, all the Jivas, or all the creatures. So one who knows this, then he quickly attains the peace. So Krishna is the enjoyer of the results of sacrifices performed by ritualist. This yajna, ritualist means the fruity activities, but he should be the enjoyer. Yajna, whatever you do, it should be offered to Krishna. Yat karoshi, yadashnasi, yajyohoshi, dadasi, yat tapasosi, kaunteya, tat kurushva, madarpanam. So everything should be done for Krishna because he is really the doer. Everything we may do as sankalpa or think in our mind, thinking, feeling, willing, but ultimately things are done by Krishna. And it is for his pleasure. He became from one to many for his pleasure. So we should give him the pleasure and we would enjoy more. If we want the real enjoyment, that is the enjoyment of the soul, then Krishna should be pleased by our all the actions, by our all the mind, body. So he is the enjoyer of the results of all the austerities performed by the jnanis. That is tapasam. Tap is done by the jnanis. And Sarvaloka Maheshwaram, he is also sitting as a Paramatma, so he is the Sarvaloka Maheshwaram. So yajna is performed by the ritualistic person, that is yajnas are done by people who want the karmakandis. Karmakandi, they do the yajna to get some higher result, higher birth, or they may go to heavenly planets to enjoy. So, but in reality, yajna should be done to satisfy Vishnu, not to go to the higher planetary system. So, the devotees who know his Brahman and Paramatma feature also know him as Bhagavan. So, all the features are there within this verse. The loving friend of all the creatures, Surodham Sarvabhutana. Thus, after describing the practice of meditation and mystic yoga in brief, so here Krishna is identifying the indwelling super soul and overseer of the material world, Paramatma feature, who is the object of the yogi's meditation. So he is really Brahman, Paramatma and Bhagavan Swayam himself. And what we see that Vaman Dev had 3 foot. So 1 foot is in Gaya, 1 foot is still imprint of that is in Gaya, another is in Swetadvip, and third one is in Makkah. So Makkah, there is a foot, but they say that it is the foot of foot of Muhammad. Muhammad's foot is there. But in reality, it is Vishnu's foot, which is worshipped in all the mosques. So indirectly, they are worshipping Vishnu. They may not know, but they are worshipping Vishnu, which is in one of the places that I read about this. So he is our dear friend. And so we should, even if we want something material, we should approach to him for liberation or for material gain. If we approach to him, then gradually he will purify our mind and we will be able to go back to our original position, and then only we can get peace. We are not in this way the enjoyers of anything, neither the controllers, and so we can be on the intimate terms with the one who is. So he is the, so if we make our terms with him, if we make our friend with him, he is our Shruhad, well-wisher. Then nothing would be lacking in us. But somehow, without knowing this principle, we are trying to worship or do in any different ways, so many different ways. So, The Lord says, Bhoktaram Yogya Tapasam. He is the actual beneficiary of all sacrifices. Not knowing this fact, less intelligent men offer sacrifices for some material benefit. To derive personal material benefits for sense gratification is the reason persons like Daksha and his followers perform sacrifices. Such sacrifices are condemned here as a labor of law without actual profit. This is confirmed in Srimad Bhagavatam. One may prosecute the Vedic injunctions of offering sacrifices and other fruity activity, but if by such activity one does not develop attraction for Vishnu, they are useless labor. So, Shrama Evahi Kevalam. So, we will read about this verse, 1-8 verse in Srimad Bhagavatam, that is, Dharma Sunisthita Punsham. Vishwakshena kathasuya notpadayed yadi ratim shramayevahi kevalam. The occupational activities a man performs according to his own position are only so much useless labor if they do not provoke attraction for the message of the personality of Godhead. So different occupational duty in terms of men's different conceptions of life. To the grass materialistic who cannot see anything beyond the grass material body, there is nothing beyond the senses. Therefore, his occupational activity are limited to concentrated and extended selfishness. Concentrated selfishness that we around the personal body, this is generally seen amongst the lower animals or who are man-like animals. And extended selfishness is in human society. They are centered around family, society, children, community, nation, world, that is with a view to grass bodily comfort. So this grass and materialist are the mental speculators who hover aloft on a mental sphere, and their occupational duties involve making poetry, philosophy, propagating some ism. So that is all selfish activity limited to the body and the mind. But above the body and mind is the dormant spirit soul, whose absence from the body makes the whole range of bodily and mental selfishness completely null and void. But less intelligent person have no information of the needs of the spirit soul. That is spirit soul, like if you are painting a cage and forgetting the bird inside it. So we are all forgetting the bird inside, which is the soul, and our soul is dying step by step, means going more and more downhill, except lower and lower bodies, and we suffer greatly. So we have to have information from the pages of Srimad Bhagavatam and Bhagavad Gita. So the need of the spirit soul that he wants to get out of the limited sphere of material bondage and fulfill his desire for complete freedom, so that freedom is in the spiritual kingdom. Here we are bound up, and that's why we are called Baddha Jivas. This complete freedom is achieved when he meets the complete spirit, the personality of Godhead. So there is a dormant affection for the God within everyone. His spiritual existence is there, manifested through the grass body and mind, but this is perverted in the grass and subtle matters. So we have to engage ourselves in occupational engagement that pleases the Lord. This is by hearing and chanting that we can do that of the Supreme Lord. And any activity which does not help one achieve attachment for hearing and chanting, then it is a waste of time. Shrama evahi kevalam. Because our occupational duty, whatever we may be doing, cannot give liberation to the soul. Even the activities of the salvationist are considered to be useless because of their failure to pick up the fountainhead of all liberties, means they do not understand about Krishna. So even if they do a salvation activity, philanthropic activity, they are of no benefit because Krishna is not happy, and without being Krishna becoming happy, we, the soul, is part and parcel, cannot be happy. Because the material gain, whatever the one materialistic they gain, it is limited only to the time, space, either in this world or higher world, but it is limited in the material world. Even if he goes up to the Swargaloka, he will find no permanent abode for his hankering soul. Hankering soul must be satisfied by perfect process of devotional service. So it is given in so many different cantos, Chaitanya Charitamrita, Shrama Evahi Kevalam, or somewhere it says that if you are beating the husk on which the rice has been taken out, you cannot get any more rice once it has been removed. So it is just beating unnecessarily means whatever we do in the material world is useless unless we develop our love for Godhead. And love for Godhead means you should have a love to chant and hear about Krishna Katha. So this is a special month, and more we do, then more we will come closer to Krishna, and ultimately would pave our way to back to Krishna, say about our real home. Because this is just a temporary situation. Even if it is a Brahmaloka, it is temporary. So one may prosecute the Vedic injunction of offering sacrifices and other fruitive activity, but by any such activity one does not develop attraction for Vishnu, they are useless labors. One who has developed the love for Vishnu must develop love and respect for the Vishnu's devotees. So Lord Shiva is the greatest of the devotees, Vaishnava Nam Yatha Sambho. So Lord Shiva is considered the foremost personality amongst the Vaishnavas. So thus, when Sati saw that her father was performing great sacrifices but had no respect for the greatest devotee Lord Shiva, she was very angry. And that is natural, that should happen. This is fitting. When Vishnu or Vaishnava is insulted, one should be angry. Lord Chaitanya, who always preached non-violence, meekness and humility, also became angry when Nityananda was offended by Jagai and Madhai, and he wanted to kill them. When Vishnu or a Vaishnava is blasphemed or dishonored, one should be very angry. Narottam Das Thakur said, Krodha Bhakta Dveshi Jane. We have anger, and that anger can be a great quality when directed against a person who is envious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead or his devotee. One should not be tolerant when a person is offensive towards Vishnu or a Vaishnava. The anger of Sati towards her father was not objectionable, for although he was her father, he was trying to insult the greatest Vaishnava. Thus Sati's anger against her father was quite applaudable. So it's a nice verse that has been given. Krishna Seva Kamarpana Krodha Bhakta Dveshi Jane Lobha Sadhu Sange Harikatha Moh Ist Labha Bine Mad Krishna Guna Gane Niyukta Kariba Yathatatha. So what is the meaning of this? That Krodha, if we are becoming angry, Krodha Bhakta Dveshi Jane, that if this is a verse from Prema Bhakti Chandrika, written by Prema Bhakti Chandrika, written by Narottam Das Thakur. One time, Gaur Kishore Das Babaji Maharaj has asked, how I can develop Krishna consciousness? He says, it suggests its caste is only 2 paisa. How come it is 2 paisa? If you read Narottam Das Thakur's Prem Bhakti Chandrika, and another is about his prayers that he has done. So in these 2 books, if you could read, which is at that time it was costing just couple paisas. So Prem Bhakti Chandrika and Prarthana, the 2 books. So Krishna Seva, so lust means so many desires can be in offering fruits of results to Krishna. Fruits my work goes to. So one can become lusty for getting the fruits and offering it to Krishna. One can become angry towards the enemies of the devotees, or envious of the devotees. And greed can be used, greed to hear about the topics of Lord Hari in association of the devotees. And if you are moh or illusion or bewilderment, how I cannot attend my worshipful Lord. So we should be in illusion, illusion could be used when we do not get our worshipful Lord. And so we should be madly glorifying the transcendental attributes of the Krishna, singing glories of Krishna. This mad or madness, there is a material madness and there is a spiritual madness. Madness, that when we become mad on ourselves, or we develop all the tears and become stunned and our throat becomes choked up. So these are even, and people also get because of the attachment to the material things. But if we get attached to Krishna, then naturally, and if we are mad for that I must get attachment to Krishna, or I must glorify the transcendental attributes of Krishna. So an ego, that I am the servant of my Lord and my Gurudev, so that is also the ego. So all these things can be used for Krishna's service. That's what सो क्रोध भक्त द्वेषी जने, क्रोध भक्त द्वेषी जने कृष्ण सेवा कामार्पणे, लोभ साधु संगे हरि कथा, मोह इष्ट लाभ बिने, मद कृष्ण गुण गणे नियुक्त करिबे यथा तथा, वेयर एवर दीज आर नीडेड, काम क्रोध लोभ मोह मद मत्सर्य, दे ऑल यू मे से एनवियस, हाउ एनवी कुड बी यूज, बट एनवी इज इन लेसर क्वांटिटी, बट इफ यू आर एनवियस ऑफ एनीबडी, नेचुरली यू शुड बी एनवियस टू द पीपल हु आर कृष्ण अपराधी, or who are not devotees of the Lord, or who are blaspheming the Lord, like Sati. I mean, she was angry, but envy also could, that we should keep away our distance from those people who are not performing their devotional service. But use of envy is much less. Nirmat Saranam Satam, this Bhagavatam is given to those people who are Nirmat Sar, who are not in any Nirmat Sara, means who are not non-envious. So this little bit about Vaishnava Parag, and when Maharaj Raghuvan, he meets the Jad Bharat, and on meeting the Jad Bharat, then he was telling so many ill things, or he is trying to blaspheme, oh, you are very thin, or you have no energy, or you think to yourself, why I should serve this king, but I am the king, and I will give the punishment, so you will remember all your life. And then he started saying Bharat Maharaj, that who I was telling him, that yes, I am neither thin nor fatty, because he was telling about the soul. You say that I am tired, but so he was telling, because he was proud of his kingman, and he wanted to take advantage of this Jad Bharat that he should carry on his palkin. Then he gave him some instructions. We understood, he got down from his cart and paid him obeisances, that and he is saying, Naham Vishanke Suraraja Vijran Natraksha Sulan Yamasya Dandat Nagnar Kasoma Nilavit Pastra Pastran Chanke Vrasham Brahma Kulava Manat. So he is saying that, my dear sir, I am not afraid of the thunderbolt of the king Indra, nor am I afraid of the serpentine piercing trident of Lord Shiva. Means neither of thunderbolt of Indra, nor am I afraid of trident of Lord Shiva. I do not care about the punishment of Yamaraj, that he puts us in so many hellish planets, the superintendent of death, nor am I afraid of fire, scorching sun, or so much coldness or wind, or neither the weapon of Kuver. Yet I am afraid of offending a Brahmana. I am very much afraid of this. So Chaitanya Mahaprabhu also gave the instruction to Rupa Goswami in the Dasashwamedh Ghat, and he pointed out very clearly the seriousness of offending a Vaishnava. Vaishnava is aparad, is like a mad elephant offense, which just ruins your Bhakti Lata Beej, which is growing, and it ruins everything. Not only that it leaves, the leaves are dried up, but also it is uprooted, your Bhakti Lata. Means even if you are in a Prema Bhakti, it could be finished. If even a pure devotee of the Lord does it, although it is very rare, but even if you are come to the Prema Bhakti stage, you could fall down. Like Bharat Maharaj fell down from his Bhava Bhakti. And even beyond the Bhava Bhakti, one Prema Bhakti, nobody falls down. But if somebody does it, then his all the devotional life is ruined. So one should definitely remember about Vaishnava Aparad, as Daksha was doing to Lada Shiva. And that's why Sati could not take any revenge from him, being her father. Then she killed by her Yoga Agni. She killed herself, although she was looking at him as if she will burn him to ashes. So we can discuss about this. It's a big topic about this mad elephant offense, that is offense of Vaishnava Aparad, and but we will keep for some other day. Or we have did discuss this. See, in also in another places it says, this nindak ekana bhetiye papi mile hajar, even so many papis, but do not meet any nindak. Ek nindak ke shish par koti papi ke bahar, that he has the weight of millions of papis. So pap and aparadh, these two are aparadh. Radha means santosh or prasannata, to be happy, to be peaceful, and apagat radha, Radh has gone too far, Santosh has gone for, that is called Aparadh. Aparadh means when your feeling of happiness or feeling of satisfaction is gone far away. If somebody is not satisfied in the material world, one should know that he is creating Vaishnava Aparadh. So that is for a devotee, he understands that, and then he should try to do the different atonement or whatever is prescribed in the Vedic literature to go and beg pardon from the whose feet you are doing the aparad, and serving them and chanting more civilly. So at this time of this Purushottam Mass, we could do more austerities to please Krishna, means to be away from any sense enjoying propensity, to take some kind of in their eating or some kind of that, I will read more or chant more or read Srimad Bhagavatam, whatever, one chapter a day. So in that way we could advance, and the results are more than thousands of times. It is even better than Kartik month. Kartik or Damodar month has the same thing, but with this today is the first day, so with this Purushottam Mass we get more result than even the Kartik month. So thank you so much. If there is any comments, discussion, then we can discuss more further. So you can unmute now. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji. Dhanvat Pranam. All good, Srila Prabhupada and Gurudev. Thank you very much for your wonderful exhibition. Hari Hari Bol.
Thank you. Hari Hari Bol.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Thank you very much. This is Damodaranand Das.
Yes, Damodaranand Prabhu. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhu. Always nice blissful to hear your lecture. Yeah. And, you know, before listening to Prabhupada's purport, the understanding of why Sati committed that act or all that happened, I had no clue, you know. I mean, always it was doubtful why this happened and why it should be. But now everything becomes so clear. So without the mercy of Guru, it's not possible for us to understand. So thank you very much, Prabhu, for explaining so nicely.
Thank you.
Hare
Krishna. Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna Prabhuji, please accept my humble obeisances. Prabhuji, as like you mentioned the various feelings such as lust, greed, envy, all those things. So envy, I heard from another devotee saying that it's the extreme side of jealousy. Where the person tries to hurt the other person unwillingly. So how is it? Even the envy is there in spiritual world also. So it's a perverted reflection. So how is that can be used in Krishna service? I thought you gave some example, but I was not very clear.
Mm-hmm. Envy's use is much less, but anyway, one should become not that he is advancing, so let me also, ispardha, rather than envy. Ispardha means it's a transcendental competition. Oh, he has distributed 1,000 books, let me distribute more. So you should do it rather than envy, it should be ispardha or competition. And if you could use that way, he has advanced, and I, not to put him down in envy, you want to put him down. You want to just see that why he has done this, why he has this, why not me? But you try to do yourself more by just taking his example. So envy should be replaced by spardha. Spardha is transcendental competition. So that could be used. And one... we should not envy any Vaishnava, but he has done so much seva, let me do even more. So that example can be taken. It's not envy. It's just a competitive spirit.
Okay, thank you, Krishna. So basically more competitive for Krishna service.
Right, right.
Okay, Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna.
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Dandavat Pranam.
Dandavat Pranam.
Thank you for wonderfully bringing this point of all the sentiments of the mind, like kama, krodha, lobha, moha, was once said. You said that envy, kama, krodha, madha, moha, matsarya, yathatata.
Yeah.
It is amazing that Narottamdas Thakur, the first five equals, he is giving a specific place to transform. And what is not specifically mentioning where the envy can be transferred. But he says somehow the yathartha means somehow or other it has to be removed, because that is the biggest obstacle because we are trying to impress Krishna, please Krishna, and our envy toward especially fellow devotees. And even this jealousy, they are the same sister, jealousy and envy. Two sides of the same coin. Narottamdas Thakur says, yathatatha means somehow or other you work it out. Then in the very following verse in that Prem Bhakti Chandrika, it describes that how we practice observing the devotees. A devotee is so dear to Krishna. Krishna is so dear that he has manifested himself in the heart of a devotee. And so, what to speak about devotees, means even to any living entity, any offensive mentality or just a harmful mentality is very bad. So, just by reminding again and again that this living entity is also the shelter of Krishna, although Krishna is the shelter of every one of us, but by his causeless mercy, he is taken the shelter of the heart of every living entity. So, jive Krishna adhishthan jani, jive samman. So, by this Vaishnava etiquette and association, we have to cultivate again and again, to decondition our envious nature. Always pointing out, am I envious of this devotee? Am I jealous of this devotee? I want to, because in competitive speed again, the same tendency comes, so now I did more. Of course, Srila Prabhupada encouraged us to do more and more and more. But ultimately, the appreciation of the devotees and appreciation of every living entity is the shelter for Krishna and Paramatma Rupa. That understanding alone will somehow or other free us from envious natures. Hare Krishna.
Okay, Hare Krishna. Just one thing I wanted to point out. Everything what we see is a reflection what is there in the spiritual world. So, kaam, krodh, lobh, moha, madha, matsarya, they are there in the spiritual kingdom, but it is in a proper perspective. So, Narottamdas Thakur is writing that if you have this krodh, just like Hanumanji showed his so much anger to Ravan, and he burned because of his angry nature, and he killed even his own son, Ravan's son. So, in this way, although in materially they are all very defective, but spiritually they could be used in Krishna service. Yes, you become anger, you become lusty, so we could offer our fruits of our work. So that's what it says, Krishna seva kamarpane, that if you have kamna, then have kamna to offer whatever you are working, yad karoshi, yadashnasi, whatever you are doing, and offer it to Krishna. So that should be the kamna or desire. Lust does not always mean a sexual desire, but it could be any kind of desire. That should be an offering our fruits to Krishna. So that should be our desire, that let me engage in your service, whatever way. Let me engage fully to my body, mind, words, I could serve you. So that should be the desire. So that is the lust could be used, the anger could be used towards the enemies of the devotees or enemies of the Supreme Lord. That's how she was angry, Sati, because Sati was angry on Daksha, because Daksha was angry. He had anger and envious nature. Both were there because so many times these things could be together. So she became very angry on Daksha because he was enemy of the Lord Shiva. So if there are any enemies, then one can show his anger also. And the greed also, that we should have greed to associate with devotees, greed to hear the topics, Krishna Katha, more and more greed, so you could read more and more. And moha, illusion, that also should be there to move for for the worshipful Lord, that we should be attached to the worshipful Lord. So madness, that is the mother, and moha, that is the bewilderment or illusion, all these things. And as I said, that ego has a less thing, but ego, that I am the servant of the Lord, that is, there is a false ego and there is a real ego, or false and there is a true ego. True ego is that I am das, jivra surupair das, so I am the das or das. So that ego we could have, and false ego that I am the master, false ego is that I am this body. So this is the false ego, so that also, so everything what we have, Narottam Das Thakur is saying that is a perverted reflection, not a real in true sense. That's why this place is condemned, because there is nothing real. But reality is in Krishna's abode. So we should try to go and serve in reality, not serving Maya, not serving the external paraphernalia, creation of the Lord, but serving the Krishna and his devotees. That should be our aim. And that's why Narottam Das Thakur is writing this verse in Prem Bhakti Chandrika. But it's your explanation is good, and thank you, I appreciate that.
Prabhu, then he describes that this calm transforms ultimately in krodh, lobha, moha, moha. So there the greater degree of this transformation of lust.
Right. Kama esha krodesha rajo guna samundo. But this calm, when you have a desire, so naturally, initially it comes in the mind, just the desire, thinking. And when you contemplate on this, then you want to enjoy. And if you want to enjoy, and if you fulfill those desires, you become more greedy. If you cannot fulfill that desire, then you become anger. So anger is more even dangerous. And then the buddhi nasha pranashati, gradually you fall down. So if you read those Bhagavad Gita 263 and 263, they describe this clearly, that how that one step to another it comes and damages you, and how you fall down into the material whirlpool by this. So I will tell you those two verses. Dhyayato vishyan punusha sangas teshu pajayate sangat sanjayate kama kamat krodo vijayate krodat bhavati sammoha sammohat smrti vibrahma smrti bhranshat buddhinasho buddhinashat pranashyati. Pranashyati means we fall down into the material whirlpool. So when we are contemplating on the sense objects, then attachment for them is born. Sangas teshu pajayate, we become more attached. Just like the Bharat Maharaj was attached to the deer because he was thinking of him. So desire, so them is born from attachment, desire is born. From desire, frustrations. And from frustration, delusion. When one is deluded, memory is lost, and with the loss of memory, the power of discrimination is destroyed. With the destruction of the discrimination, one's own self is lost. We lost into the material whirlpool. Smriti bhranshat buddhinasho buddhinashat pranashyati. If our intelligence is gone, then we would be like animals. Human beings, they have intelligence, that how to use it properly. Means intelligence for selfishness is there in even the insects and animals all there, but that is by instinct. But we have given a special prerogative of this intelligence, that we could, that how everything is damaging, nobody is really happy, nobody. Then one should turn towards his spirituality, and so that discrimination power is devotees develop more and more. Anything is all material, world is illusory, it is temporary, It does not give any pleasure to anyone. So our place is in the spiritual kingdom where we should belong to, where we should go and perform our devotional service. So just by desiring gracefully, then this calm and crowd and so desiring is like, that is the kamna. Kamna means desire. But then it leads further. If it is not towards spirituality, then it leads further to greed, anger, madness, all these six qualities, they come in the picture. And by this you fall down into the material realm and so many 8.4 million species of life.
Regarding can envy, Prabhu, we are discussing. Prabhu asked a very nice question that how envy
can be used.
So envy can be compared to like the fifth level or sixth level kinship level.
Right.
It doesn't have their regular procedures. Others
have their more play.
Exactly. So in that purpose, it's like some mercy is needed. When somebody is lost case in medical science also, certain diseases are definitely required. But by some mercy or some charnamit or some special favor. So that's why Nautam Das Thakur so wonderfully says that somehow when we are in association of devotees, we work out that please Krishna, we are aspiring to attain your special mercy and care. And how am I envious of these devotees? These devotees are so wonderful. We have benefited from devotees so much. How many wonderful qualities they have. So rather than seeing, undermining them and becoming envious, somehow or other we have to work out that because this envy cannot be transferred to any other space. And because there is no space even in the spiritual world for envy. So we have to work out if you want to attain the abode of the Lord. And only by seeing appreciably the devotees and every living entity. That's the only way. Because envy is the final stage, last stage, and we have to beg out from Krishna and Vaishnavas that we become free from envy by respecting, by honoring their position, that they are so dear to Krishna. If we want to envy ourselves to Krishna, we have to see other devotees very dear to Krishna. As much as I want to think that I am so dear to Krishna because I am a devotee of Krishna, what about others? So,
Thank you.
Hare Krishna, Prabhu, Dandavach Pranam.
Hare Krishna, Dandavach
Pranam. This is Rupavati Kishori Devi Dasi. Prabhu, my question is, like in previous verse, as we read that as Sati, she left, she didn't hear Lord Shiva. And she left a Vaishnava and she followed her own wish. That's why she had to suffer humiliation and stuff. And in today's verse, it was like, it was, I mean, even though she had envy and anger, she used it in service because she was defending a Vaishnava. So how can we understand this contradictory nature?
She came because he was the father and there were his sisters and everybody was coming. It's a woman's nature to dress up and go to some festivities, and so she went there, but also she had in her mind to see that whether Lord Shiva is being given a proper respect and proper place in this yajna, so what his father is doing. So she went and she was greeted nicely by her sisters and her mother, but Daksha Prajapati's aim was, although she was a loving daughter, the youngest one, and but he did not even speak a single word. And that caused more, and then when she saw that there is no place, or there in the mantras there is no swaha pranam, for Lord Shiva, then she become more angry that his father is so envious of the of my husband, which is not proper. Not just because of her bodily relation, but he is the greatest of the Vaishnava by all means. And all the demigods and everybody takes shelter of him. All the Vaishnavas take shelter of him. He is the topmost Vaishnava. And now here he is performing the yajna, which is meant to please Vishnu. And how it would be without offering oblations to Lord Shiva, how Vishnu would be pleased. And so these are the limbs of the Lord. The demigods are the limbs, officers, directors of the Lord Vishnu. And when they are blasphemed, means we should give respect like even to an insect. What to say about Lord Shiva? She was neglecting all this. That was all because of his envious nature. So she became very angry. And rather than hurting her own father, which she could have done it if she wanted to, she could have just by her own anger, she could have burned, or by her words or sharp, like by he could have been condemned. But she just wanted to give her body. That is because of the previous pastime of the Lord that she acted as. One time she made the form of Sita Devi, which is worshipable deity for Lord Shiva. So he rejected in mind to Sati, to his own wife. So Sati had to take another birth as Parvati, or daughter of Himwan. Then he got married again. Just that body made the another body's form, or her own, like Lord Shiva's own worshipable deities, Lord Sita and Ram. So Shiva was rejected in his mind, and that is how these things took place later on. That Sati had to give her body, and so it teaches Lord's activities are fulfills so many thousands and thousands of things together. It's not just for one purpose. Although the purpose here of Sati's coming was to be with parents, with sisters, with other demigods. So that is one thing. Also, she wanted to see the place for the Lord Shiva, whether it is there and why they have, why her father is envious to such an exalted personality. She knew that. And she came out. It is not something to go to the father's house, that although she wanted to take permission from Lord Shiva, but he did not give it. So she came. So it is not contradictory whether it is not invited, or one can go to the parents' house. Not that there is a need to be, but Lord Shiva did refuse her, and she should have accepted. But the destiny was that she give up her current body and take a new body, so she could serve Lord more closely. And there was a need for Kartikeya to take birth, and for Ganesh to take birth, or at least Kartikeya to become the chief of the like all the military, because the demons were hurting so much to the devatas. So when they approach, they say when Shiva's son becomes the commander in chief, and then he will kill, or he will get the victory over all the asuras. But how the Sati was gone, Lord Shiva was in meditation, so then Sati was born as Parvati, and she gets married, and then there was a son. So for demigods, it may look to us for so many thousands of years, but from demigod point of view, it is not that long period. So they waited. Lord Shiva was like, even Indra, and they sent a Kamdev also initially, but Kamdev was burned. But she continued her prayers to Lord Shiva, this Parvati, and ultimately Shiva woke up, and then he got married to Parvati, and then there was a son and who killed. So there is a long thing. So by any activity we see in pages of Bhagavatam, like this deer. Deer was some kind of this deer that Bharat Maharaj was fell in love. So he was some different person in the last life. So anytime we read, there are so many things what happened, we could understand that there is a previous history of all these things what we hear in Bhagavatam. So to fulfill all the desires, we may not see that what is the reason behind, but there is some reason behind all these things. By Sati to come, means they are also Leela, pastimes, they are for their play, or they are something to happen new, which is already foretold, and that's why they do all these activities.
Thank you.
So it's not that she did not accept. Lord Shiva never blasphemed, why you did not hear to me. Now you see the result. Anyway, she burned herself at that fire sacrifice. But that is one of, we should take it also to reveal us something for our learning. And some also that wherever Sati's body fell down, then they became a places for Shakti Pithas. And Lord Krishna blessed when she transferred Sati or Durga or Mahamaya or even Yogamaya, transferred from the womb of Devaki to womb of Rohini to Balram. So, and then he said, he blessed her that you will be known by all this. So he told, I think, there are 17 names of Sati or Parvati that has been given in Srimad Bhagavatam. So they all had to come true. And that's so that, like he said, that you will be Vaishnavi and you will be Kushmanda and you will be so many names that I don't remember all those names, but these are all the names of Durga, Parvati, Arsati, who took birth and she had all these places. So that also had to come true by the blessings of the Lord, because she did perform such a great task of transferring one womb to another womb. It's not an easy task, but she did it without even knowledge of either Devaki or no knowledge of either the Rohini Mataji.
Thank you, Prabhu.
So it's not something
so
out of place, but there is some place in pages of Bhagavatam. It was not out of disrespect to Lord Shiva, but she had the natural right to go to her parents' house.
Yeah, makes sense, Prabhu. Thank you, Prabhu.
You're welcome. Any other discussions that we have? Yeah, Hare Krishna.
Wonderful class, Prabhuji, as always, and we all love your classes. Prabhuji, Sati should follow the instruction of her husband, and second thing is, she did not follow and she went there, and she has to face such a big opposition from all of them, and nobody was helping her. And finally, she entered into sacrificial fire. So, is that the thing she did correct, or she should have gone back to her husband like that?
I could not follow your question completely. But Sati, yes, she did not follow her husband. So that is also one of the instruction, that if there is a personality like Mahadev, her own worshipable Lord and Master, her husband, so that could be the also one of the reasons. But also according to the Shastra, one can go to the parents' house if there is some great festival or something is happening. And so anyway, these things are, yes, there you could learn multitudes of things. From these pages of Bhagavatam. So our great acharyas, they derive many things from there, like churning the ocean and bringing out certain favorable points, so we could adopt in our own life and we could advance in Krishna consciousness for our benefit.
Yes, Prabhuji, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay.
Hare Krishna, anybody else has any question?
Hare Krishna, Prabhuji, Dhanat Pranam, Srila Prabhupada, Kijay, Dhanat Pranam.
Jai Srila Prabhupada.
So, Prabhuji, Subhadra Mata is Parvati Mata or Sati or Mahamaya, Who is she?
Yeah, Subhadra is not Sati or Parvati, not Mahamaya, but also Yogamaya. Also, there are different personalities who act as Yogamaya. But she is the younger sister of Krishna, married to Arjun, although Balramji wanted her to get married to Duryodhan, but nonetheless, she is the eternal consort of Arjun, who is not an ordinary person, who is a perfect devotee, friend of the Lord, and they are eternal associates of the Lord. And so he wanted her to get married, but this Durga are completely separate. Subhadra is completely separate from Durga or Sati, or have no relation with them. In the power or anything, she is like a Yogamaya, but not Mahamaya. Mahamaya keeps us bewildered into the material world and keeps us into the material world. So she is testing us. But Subhadra does not test. She helps in the pastimes of the Lord. And so you could say that herself, Subhadra Devi or Purnamasi or Vrinda Devi, they are also Yogamaya in one sense. Means it's the energy of the Lord who enacts the pastime, who lets the pastimes of the Lord happen without his knowledge. Like Krishna did not know his God, he was just playing like a child, and he could enjoy his childhood. But if he knows all the time that he is the Supreme Lord, so who makes him forget that he is the Supreme Lord? So that forgetfulness comes in the Supreme Lord, and he likes that by the Vrinda Devi or by Yogamaya. So Yogamaya affects the devotees and Krishna in his pastime, and Mahamaya helps to keep the living being into the material world until we get completely purified. Okay?
Thank you, Prabhu.
Okay, Hare Krishna. So I have another call now, so just hold on, or we may finish. Hare, okay? Hare Krishna? Oh, tomorrow? Oh, Dandar Phalam, Jaisila Prabhu. So, yeah, what about better that you just tell me now? Okay. I will take. Okay. Yeah. From 7:20. Okay. Thank you. Hare Krishna. Yes, hello, Hare Krishna.
Yes,
sorry,
sir,
to hold you in between.
Hare Krishna.
So we can end our class?
I think so, because no one has any questions. So, thank you.
Thanks to all the devotees. And all the best wishes for this Purushottam Mass to everyone. All glories to Srila Prabhupada and all the Vaishnavas. So, please accept my condolences. Vancha kalpataru bhyasya prabhasayu bhyavichya patitanam bhavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namah. Ananda Koti, Vaishnava Vrinda Ki Jai. Jai Shri Krishna.